Most people who have experienced it will swear they'll never do it again, and those people usually fail. So, what is it we're talking about? A hangover, of course. You might think that hangovers are just funny college memories, but the U.S. Centers for Disease Control found that the cost of excessive alcohol consumption in the United States in 2006 reached almost $223.5 billion, or about $1.90 per drink. Most of the costs, up to 72%, came from declines in workplace productivity, a fact that anyone who's tried to do data entry in Excel in the morning after their best friend's birthday will fully understand. But what exactly is a hangover? Why does drinking so much lead your body to hate you and break down after all the alcohol has left your system? Was your roommate right when they told you beer before liquor, never been sicker? Or did he have no idea what he was talking about? And what, if anything, can you actually do to get over it? We investigated this phenomenon by going deep into medical texts, research, and of course several bars. After a few days of recuperation, here is what we found. Though alcohol is a depressant, in low doses it generally makes people feel quite good. With a couple of drinks, people tend to feel happier, more sociable, and slightly less inhibited, until they get several drinks in and suddenly remember that maybe their ex was the best thing to ever happen to them, and they make several ill-advised phone calls and wake up with the unique, beautiful mixture of shame and regret that only vodka can cause. But depending on the person, the situation, and the age, even having just a few drinks can cause a terrible hangover the next day. So how does alcohol cause you to feel this way after it's essentially gone from your system? Well, first off, it's important to note that hangovers aren't generally just one sensation or caused by only one thing. In general, hangover symptoms can include one, some, or even all of the following: sleepiness, headaches, general body aches, lack of focus, dry mouth, dizziness, sweating, nausea, irritability and mood swings, inflammation, digestive problems, and perhaps some changes in how often and how, in general, you go to the bathroom. We don't need to go too deep on that last one. A hangover usually happens for a whole host of reasons rather than just one specific cause. Number one is the byproduct of your body processing alcohol in the first place. Alcohol, or more specifically the ethanol in it, is processed by your liver as a toxin. When you drink high doses of it, your body has to work much harder to get rid of the alcohol in your system. This means that the enzyme known as alcohol dehydrogenase, ADH, goes into overdrive, breaking down the ethanol coming its way. As the enzyme breaks down the ethanol, it creates a byproduct known as acetaldehyde, CH3CHO, which is actually toxic in itself. Acetaldehyde doesn't stick around for too long, it eventually gets further broken down into acetate, which is significantly less toxic, and then lastly into carbon dioxide and water. However, when someone has had a fair amount to drink, it takes the body longer to break down the acetaldehyde into acetate, meaning the former hangs around in the liver and in the body for way longer than it usually would, and it wreaks havoc. This is usually also the time that hangover symptoms are the worst, generally the morning after a big night out. Acetaldehyde causes inflammation in several major organs, including the liver, where most alcohol breakdown takes place, the pancreas, the gastrointestinal tract, and the brain. These three organs are primarily mentioned because, though the liver does the bulk of the work in processing alcohol, the brain, the pancreas, and the GI tract do also help break it down. The irritation of the GI tract causes inflammation that contributes to the feeling of nausea and sometimes indigestion that accompanies hangovers. That's because the GI tract increases the release of acid in response to irritants, upsetting your stomach quite a lot. Frequent binge drinkers can also develop ulcers for this same reason. Repeated irritation of the gastrointestinal system will lead to a buildup of acid over time, potentially leading to ulcers. Because acetaldehyde is toxic to the body, scientists also believe it's a major reason why people experience not only nausea, but vomiting and sweating during particularly bad hangovers. The body is literally reacting to the poison within it. Another inflammatory response that happens concerns the immune system. According to WebMD, the foremost source for convincing you your toothache is cancer, studies found that people experiencing hangovers had high levels of cytokines. Cytokines are messenger proteins for your immune system. Finding high levels of them in a hungover state seems to indicate that excessive alcohol ingestion triggers an immune response in the body. One reason why some people might experience much worse hangovers than others, even when having drunk the exact same amount as their friends, is genetic. People generally have different levels of the alcohol dehydrogenase enzyme, meaning they can break down and metabolize ethanol at very different speeds. those who have less of the enzyme are likely to experience worse hangovers that last longer. For example, many people of East Asian descent have an enzyme mutation known as ALDH2. This mutation makes it very difficult for them to process alcohol as well as people that have ALDH enzymes. Not only does this affect how alcohol is processed, leading to the well-known reddish skin known as a flush reaction for those with ALDH2, but also cardiovascular issues, asthma, and much more intense hangover symptoms. And the bad news is, hangovers in general aren't always over in a couple of hours. In fact, hangovers can last up to 72 hours, causing symptoms like drowsiness, lack of focus, and aches well into the next couple of days. If you're 22, you might find this length of hangover time hard to believe, but trust us and give it a few years. However, as we said before, there are multiple factors that cause hangovers, and that's part of the reason why the duration, intensity, and even presence of hangovers in the first place are so variable among different people and circumstances. After all, the Cleveland Clinic states that about 75% of people who drink too much tend to get hangovers, while anywhere from 25% to 30% of people who recently drank too much seem to be resistant to them. So besides the nitty-gritty of enzymes and genes, what's happening to perhaps worsen your hangover symptoms? And how do some of those lucky people seemingly avoid all the negative after effects of a very good night out or a very sad night in? Though we don't really have an answer to why some people seem to skip hangovers completely other than good preventative measures, which we'll delve into later, we do know there are several other factors that can make your hangovers worse. For example, here is where we have to admit that the type of alcohol you ingest may in fact matter. There are two compounds found in various spirits and alcoholic beverages that have major effects on your body. The first is sulfites. Sulfites are commonly found in wine, where they both occur naturally and are added as preservatives. Though sulfites don't necessarily affect everyone, some people do have a sensitivity to them. If you have an issue with sulfites, you'll also likely experience symptoms after ingesting lemon juice, dried fruit, and molasses, which also have high levels of the compound. What does this mean for your hangovers? If you have a sulfite sensitivity, drinking wine will likely trigger a much worse hangover reaction than having a beer or liquor would. Another more general class of compounds you might find in darker liquors is called congeners. These are products produced during the fermentation process, other than the main product of ethyl alcohol. They include esters, tannins, methanol, acetone, and the aforementioned sulfites. Though pretty much all the fermented alcoholic products have congeners, darker liquids like bourbon will have a lot more of them. Any alcohol that's been aged in a barrel is especially susceptible to high levels of congeners, which is why that expensive premium-aged whiskey is probably going to give you the migraine of your life. The difference between lighter and darker colored liquors isn't small. One study found that bourbon had 37 times the amount of congeners found in vodka. The reason these congeners worsen hangover symptoms is because they're toxic. Acetone, for example, is most commonly known as the primary component of nail polish remover. Methanol is more toxic than alcohol and is actually the compound responsible for many moonshine and homemade alcohol brewing poisonings. When your liver metabolizes methanol, it produces formaldehyde and formic acid, both of which are incredibly bad for you. Though the levels of methanol in commercially produced alcohol are negligible, meaning not enough to poison you badly, they're still high enough to affect the severity of your hangover symptoms. But let's say you avoid wine, avoid dark liquor, stick only to beer or clear liquor, yet you feel insanely hungover the next day. What else is happening to worsen your hangover? Well, first, drinking excessively in the first place drastically affects your quality of sleep. Of the many, many hormones excessive drinking disrupts, melatonin might be one of the worst hit. As sleep medicine specialist Dr. Aristides Iatridis says, people who drink alcohol tend to have very broken sleep and don't sleep well. Drunk people tend to wake up after just a few hours of sleep and almost skip rapid eye movement or REM sleep altogether. They wake up early because, since alcohol is a depressant, your body has the tendency to want to bounce right back up as the ethanol is metabolized out of your system. Unfortunately, this often happens 3 or 4 hours after you pass out face down and drool on your pillow. The REM disruption is equally problematic. REM is the deepest part of the sleep cycle, the most restorative part of sleep, and the time which most of your dreams occur. Alcohol drastically cuts down on the amount of REM sleep you experience, meaning not only do you miss the dream sequences involving Margot Robbie thanking you for saving the universe from Klingons, all happening for whatever reason in your old middle school, but you also don't get much, actual rest. So combine the problem of only a few actual sleeping hours with missing the restful parts of sleep, and no wonder you're cranky, drowsy, and you can't focus the next day, even without the toxic byproducts of alcohol floating through your system. Of course, some of the remaining hangover symptoms you experience can be explained by the other major culprit of hangovers, dehydration. Your friend who told you to gulp down a bottle of water before going to sleep after a night out might have been on to something. Among its many functions, a social lubricant, a toxin, a regret machine, alcohol is also a diuretic. That means it leaches water out of your body as it's coursing through it, seriously dehydrating you. If you're not compensating for this loss of water with a lot of extra drinks on a night out, and we mean non-alcoholic ones to be clear, the next day's hangover will hit you like a sack of bricks. Dehydration's also the reason many people experiencing hangovers wake up feeling like someone sandpapered the inside of their mouth. This is known as dry mouth. In addition, dehydration can also contribute to nausea, inflammation, and general puffiness. Ever notice that when you're hungover, any jewelry on your fingers or a band around your wrist is suddenly cutting off your circulation? That's the bloating caused by dehydration. The reason alcohol also leads to headaches is a combination of this dehydration and the fact that alcohol has a tendency to dilate your blood vessels, including the ones in your brain. This dilation often triggers headaches, which leaves us with the emotional aspects of the hangover. Why do people get irritable, anxious, and generally moody while hungover? You know, beside the fact that they're sleep deprived, have a pounding headache, and have spent half the morning throwing up. Well, while those are very valid reasons to be a bit cranky, there are actual hormonal changes happening within you during a hangover as well. Alcohol generally functions like a wrecking ball when it comes to your hormones. That's why drinking alcohol can have very different effects on you depending on the amount consumed, your state of mind, and how recently you had your last drink. After all, we've seen people who are seemingly incapable of having a fourth beer without crying in the corner about how everyone hates them and they're going to die alone, or wanting to fight everyone in line at the bathroom. Clearly, alcohol makes a lot of people feel some type of way. The endocrine system, which is in charge of your hormone production and general communication, is shaken upside down by alcohol. This leads to big hormonal disturbances. If you don't have a drinking problem, those are temporary, limited to embarrassing emotional confessions at the bar and feeling like death the day after. People who do have drinking problems end up experiencing much more serious and sometimes permanent changes in their hormones and behavior. According to the National Library of Medicine, these include stress abnormalities, reproductive deficits, body growth defects, thyroid problems, immune dysfunction, cancers, bone disease, and psychological and behavioral disorders. As with most hangover causes, there are hormonal, behavioral, and practical reasons for your mood swings and crankiness during a hangover as well. A lot of hangover symptoms tend to intensify each other, as nausea and an inability to focus on your work, for example, might make you feel pretty annoyed at yourself and generally horrible. Since drunk people have lowered inhibitions and pretty poor judgment, it's possible at least some hangover moodiness comes from remembering bad decisions you made the night before, or things you said or did that you now regret. Last night's bid to win your ex back with a "you up" might have seemed like the most logical course of action at the time, but today's response of "for real, this time I'm blocking you" might have put things in a different perspective. Another reason hangovers make you feel worse is because hangovers are, in a way, a mild withdrawal. Your brain adjusted to feeling slightly high and euphoric while drunk, and now the return to your baseline mood and natural state of being feels like an unwanted come down. Now that we know why hangovers happen, what can we do about them? First off, most quick and easy hangover cures people offer don't do much to actually help. It's important to be able to tell apart which hangover cures have any sort of scientific backing and which are just bogus myths. For example, you might have heard that eating a raw egg, while disgusting, will cure your hangover. Setting aside the problem of how one would even swallow and be able to keep down a raw egg while nauseous, does this actually work? Eggs contain a compound called cysteine, which breaks down acetaldehyde. Since this is the primary substance responsible for your hangover, that means that a couple of eggs over easy in the morning can help your body get rid of all the acetaldehyde floating through it that much faster. One hangover cure that doesn't really work to counteract most of alcohol's effects, though it might temporarily make you feel better, is coffee. We won't advise you not to drink it, as the caffeine can help give you a little boost of energy to get through your day, and the tendency of coffee to make your blood vessels constrict can counteract a hangover headache. However, coffee is, like alcohol, a diuretic, meaning that it might provide temporary relief for your drowsiness and head pain, but eventually, it's probably only going to make you feel worse, as it'll further dehydrate you. A surprisingly effective morning after hangover cure we hardly see mentioned at all is bananas. One of the minerals in your body most affected by dehydration is potassium. The high potassium levels of bananas help you replenish your mineral stores. You can also eat other high potassium fruits like kiwis for the same effect. In fact, food in general can have a pretty great preventative effect for hangovers. Drinking on an empty stomach is a surefire way to end up drunk and with a massive hangover. This is both because without food, you will immediately start feeling the effects of alcohol, including lowered inhibition, leading you to drink more, and because the alcohol will generally be absorbed into your system at a slower rate on a full stomach. There's also evidence suggesting that your overall blood alcohol content won't get nearly as high on a full stomach as an empty one. Some Swedish researchers decided to get people drunk on two different days. On one day, they were coming off an overnight fast, and on the other, they had just eaten a hearty breakfast. The day the test subjects drank after a full breakfast, their BAC levels only went up to 70% of what they did the day they were fasting, which makes a pretty good case for eating a nice full meal before drinking alcohol. Since two of the biggest compounding causes of hangovers are dehydration and a lack of sleep, there are also two common cures for your symptoms: drinking water and going back to sleep. Now, when we say cures in general in this article, it doesn't mean that one drink of water or one hard-boiled egg will suddenly make you feel like you can run a marathon. Let's face it, most of us couldn't even run in our sober state anyway. It just means the severity and the length of your hangover symptoms will diminish, so instead of dealing with an all-day can't-get-out-of-bed total body breakdown, you might just have a few hours of feeling tired with a slight headache instead. That being said, going back to sleep as much as you can, providing you have the ability to do so and don't have to show up to work, can help you get through a hangover that much faster. Water is an even better cure because water can actually function as a hangover prevention. If you find yourself drinking a lot more than you anticipated throughout the night, make sure you're taking some time between drinks to chug some water as well. Then have some more water before you go to sleep. This will hopefully counteract the diuretic effect of the alcohol and minimize the severity of your eventual dehydration. One hangover remedy that definitely won't work is one of the most popular ones out there: hair of the dog. For the uninitiated, hair of the dog translates to continue drinking to avoid a hangover. Now, as you might imagine, there's no real scientific backing for the concept of drinking more alcohol to avoid the toxic effects of too much alcohol. However, what drinking more alcohol will do is not only delay your hangover by a few hours, as you will continue to feel either tipsy or drunk instead of hungover for a little while longer, but actually it'll make your hangover that much worse when it eventually hits. Because all you're doing is throwing more ethanol in your liver's direction for it to metabolize, meaning you're building more toxins up in your body that'll make your hangover hit harder when it comes around. So unless your plan is to keep drinking alcohol forever, which it should be said we strongly do not recommend, the hair of the dog will do nothing to help. And of course, we have to answer the age-old question: does beer before liquor actually make you sicker? And does liquor before beer mean you're in the clear? We're sorry to disappoint, but as persistent as this advice and myth is, it's also wrong. At the end of the day, it's the total amount of alcohol you consume that makes the difference, slightly affected by what type it is, as mentioned before. However, the order in which people consume the drinks seem to make no difference in how drunk they got or how bad their hangovers were the day after. The only reason we can think of why this piece of wisdom ever started floating around is that if someone is drinking everything at the same speed, beer will get them intoxicated at a slower pace than liquor, as a serving of beer generally has more liquid and takes longer to drink than a serving of liquor. So it's possible that people starting their nights with beer wouldn't feel the effects of the alcohol that rapidly at first and be encouraged to drink more throughout the night, while those drinking liquor would start to notice themselves becoming drunk much earlier and perhaps take it easy. However, this is just our own theory for why this saying may have come about. At the end of the day, the why doesn't matter as much as the fact that it is just plain wrong. Now check out what happens to your body when you stop drinking alcohol, or watch this instead.